Hi, I'm Dr. Jyotsna Batra. I'm a senior research fellow here at Translational Research Institute, Queensland University of Technology. And my research is focused on understanding the genetics of prostate cancer, which can lead to discovery of new biomarkers for prostate cancer. So I work on prostate cancer, right? And prostate cancer is a kind of a cancer which you could detect easily because of the existing prostate-specific antigen test. It's a blood-based test. But the problem with this disease is that it leads to the overdiagnosis. And once patients are diagnosed, like they're told that their PSA is rising, they just can't sit quiet. They want to do something about it, which leads to them getting some sort of treatment, and this leads to the reduced quality of life. So where I want to see my research going is to develop something which can add on to this test, really making it very sensitive as well as specific, so we can identify those patients which need immediate treatment and also can find those patients which can just go with active surveillance so they do not suffer from their reduced quality of life. And I'm pretty sure that we'll be able to achieve this in the next 10 years.
Hello, my name is Dr. James Wells and I work at the University of Queensland Diamantina Institute. My Cancer Council project looks at squamous cell carcinoma, which is a type of skin cancer. And we know that patients who are immunosuppressed, for example, those patients who receive transplanted organs, develop skin cancer. So this project is really about trying to understand why those patients develop skin cancer, so that we can then develop better treatments for them. So in 5 to 10 years' time, one of the main outcomes of this grant will be that we will develop a topical treatment for patients who are immunosuppressed, transplant patients, to reduce their risk of developing skin cancer.
My name is Dr. Graham Leggett. I'm from the University of Queensland Diamantina Institute. It's quite exciting. We're looking at non-melanoma skin cancer, which you may be aware is the most commonly diagnosed cancer in Australia. It's particularly a problem in Queensland because we have the outdoor lifestyle and a lot of UV light exposure, which is one of the causative agents of the cancer. So what we're interested in is commonly at the moment you would actually get these things surgically cut out. But what we're going to do is look at immune-based treatments. So we know that on immune cells we have inhibitory receptors and we have receptors that will activate the immune response. And the problem with this cancer is that the cancer interacts with the inhibitory receptors and turns off our immune response, and that's a bad thing. So what we actually want to do is block that interaction so that we can now promote the immune system again to treat the cancer. I've had a patient ring me actually and say, I've got all of these cancers on my face. I'm going in for surgery. They've got to cut these things off my face. I've got to see a plastic surgeon. Surely there's a better way that won't disfigure me. And I tend to agree. And she also suggested, she said, well, why don't we attack this thing from the inside? And I said, well, that's exactly what the immune system can do.
So I'm Kirash Kusratarani, I'm a dermatologist at UQ Diamantina Institute. A large majority of people now in Australia are diagnosed for their melanoma quite early on. So they have thin melanomas. So this is like over 80% of patients. But still, 80% of this large group of patients, you know, there's a tiny proportion of them who still die from melanoma. And that's what we announce when we find that someone has a thin melanoma. We usually tell them, oh, you're fine, you have 96% chance of survival for 20 years. But that 4% that don't survive, 4% of a lot, is still a lot of patients that actually end up dying from melanoma. So we really have to find ways to predict who those 4% are among this big pile of people who get thin melanomas in Queensland and also in Australia in general. So that's what the project is about, is to really compare what are the characteristics of the melanomas from this unlucky 4% compared to the rest of the population. And if we find differences, you know, can we actually use that as a predictor? So there are other categories of melanomas that are actually much thicker. So this is a more rare occurrence. So, you know, the few patients actually get these thick melanomas because we diagnose them early usually. But we've done this same sort of approach in these thicker melanomas, and we have identified markers that can predict which patients will actually progress to metastases and die from the disease. So obviously we're going to try these same markers on these thin melanomas, but maybe they won't be the right ones, but at least we know, we have some evidence that this is working. And a lot of the markers that we found so far are related to the to that immune response and to the capacity to react against the tumor.
My name is Li Zhang. I'm a senior research fellow in Griffith University. Nearly all the cancer patients will need to have an intravascular catheter during their anti-cancer therapy. And all these cancer patients have really high risk for the bloodstream infection. And according to the research and also the CDC guideline, needleless connector will be the main infection source. Unfortunately, not much research have been done in this field. So my project will focus on to find the better design of the needleless connector to reduce the bloodstream infection, and also find what's the best clinical practice to reduce the bloodstream infection. Every year we have around 400 patients died of bloodstream infection instead of the cancer. We are hoping to do this clinical trial with 200 patients in Wesley Hospital and 200 patients in Townsville Hospital.
Hi, I'm Antiope Virelius, and I'm based here at the QMR Berghofer Medical Research Institute. I work in the Bone Marrow Transplantation Laboratory, headed by Professor Jeff Hill. My research is focused on making bone marrow transplantation a safer therapy for people with hematological malignancies like lymphomas, leukemias, myelomas. And the major complication that happens after transplantation is graft versus host disease, and that limits its application as a therapy for those diseases. With a view of a better understanding of the disease process will mean that we will be able to develop better therapeutic strategies. We have published that there are important molecules that can control graft versus host disease, and what we're wanting to now do is further those studies and in particular look at bacteria and how bacteria can contribute to the disease process. I'd like to be able to say that we will have a better understanding of the disease, and that we're in a position to develop newer treatments which are going to be safer for the people who need to have a transplant.
My name is Alfie Yap. I'm a professor at the University of Queensland, and I'm based here at the Institute for Molecular Bioscience on the UQ St Lucia campus. How cancer cells behave is ultimately what determines their outcome, their impact on our health or otherwise. And what we now know is that how cancer cells interact with other cells, other cancer cells, but also the normal tissue cells from which they come. How they interact is a key to how they behave. And what we're trying to do is understand the processes that control how they interact normally and how that's perturbed in cancer and when cancer progresses.
Hi, my name is Siok Tae. I'm working as a postdoc at the QMR Berghofer Bone Marrow Transplant Laboratory. One of the main complications of bone marrow transplantation is graft versus host disease. It might sound like a mouthful, but some patients do have significant complications, and that manifests itself as skin problems, lung problems, and potentially a lot of other problems long term. One of the most effective treatments for leukemia is a bone marrow transplant, but unfortunately bone marrow transplantation can be complicated by a condition we call graft versus host disease. So in this project, what we're trying to do is we are trying to get the cells from the donors who donated the bone marrow in the first instance, pick out a particular type of cell called regulatory T cells, grow it up in the lab, and then give it back to the patient and see if we can make their graft versus host disease better. So whilst this approach of using regulatory T cells to treat graft-versus-host disease has been tried by a few other institutions, not many, nobody really knows what happens to these cells. And if you don't know what happens to them, you don't know how to make them better. You don't know how many you need. You don't know if you're giving enough because you can't measure it, unlike a drug, you know. So what we'll do is we will actually genetically mark these cells. And what that allows us to do is allows us to track them in the patient. And nobody else in the world has done this before. So this would be a world first if we can pull this off. And we will track these cells, and not only that, we will then be able to give the patient some other medications that is known to be able to boost the number of regulatory T cells. I see my research as an extension to being a clinician, you know, I mean, there's not a lot of joy, I think, necessarily in doing the same thing day in, day out if you know that it's not going to get any better. And I think if my research can improve this for my patients, I see that as part of my job, really.